Good evening, and welcome again to Public Perspective. I'm your host, Kevin McDermott. And tonight, we're revisiting with a friend of ours, Professor Pablo Boczkowsk, professor of communications at Northwestern University, to talk about his new book, The News Gap. Professor Boczkowsk, welcome back to the show.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Pleasure to be here.
Well, before we even start about the news gap and what it is, let's talk about the changing nature of media. People are watching this show possibly on old-fashioned over-the-air media and maybe on the internet.
Correct.
So what have we seen in the world of media that prompted you to take a new look at things like the news gap? How are things changing in this world as a whole?
Excellent question. So if we think about the media business, the media industry over the past 100 years or so, we see that first we had radio and newspapers. Then we had television. The combination of these three created a traditional media structure in which in most markets, in most cities, in most towns, in most regions, there were only a handful of players, right? In a town, there would be one or maybe two newspapers, three television networks, and a handful of radio stations. Mm-hmm. That meant that there was a huge market, you know, in terms of customers, with only a handful of organizations providing contact to the consumers for the advertisers. So advertisers had to come to these organizations if they wanted to reach the consumers.
Very little alternative for the advertisers. If you want to get to the audience, these are the only ways to do it.
Correct. That meant that the public service mission of journalism, that is telling the public what the public needs to know in order to function as informed members of the citizenry, could be served while still getting huge amounts of profits from the advertising side, because, as you said, there were very few alternatives, so these organizations could charge fairly reasonable rates and get funding for their public service journalism through these means. We go back to 1980, the first all-news cable television station, CNN, television network, CNN. That increased substantially the volume of news coverage and the competition, and in particular when the commercial web came along, because the internet long predates cable television. 1960s, the internet had already existed, but it was used for research or for defense purposes. In the mid-1990s, the internet gets commercialized, and the web, as sort of the main platform for people to connect to the internet, becomes a public success, a commercial success, and media organizations start to share their news, their advertising, their content on the web. That completely transformed the nature of the media industry. It became much, much more competitive, many more alternatives, and that meant that for advertisers, they had many ways of reaching, many more ways of reaching the customers, including directly appealing to the customer. If you are a Ford Motor Company, right, you set up your own website and you reach your customers directly. Even if you are a small organization, even a small restaurant, you have your own website and you can reach your own customers. Right? So what has happened over the past 100 years is that the media business, which had usually a handful of very strong players, which had a very powerful market position, as the economists or the strategists would say, got transformed into a much, much more competitive environment with many more players, which, relatively speaking, now have a much weaker position than what they had market-wise, than what they had decades ago. That means that the public service mission of journalism, telling people what they need to know in order to function as informed members of the citizenry, which usually is news about the government, news about international affairs, political news in general, and business and financial news, is still enacted, is still undertaken by traditional news organizations, but is not necessarily so well funded through the advertising side of the house, because the bottom line of these organizations is hurting.
Because the advertisers have so many other alternatives that it's hard to bring in the advertising dollars that were really almost guaranteed prior to this in the much more constrained competitive environment.
Correct.
So as a result, the news stations have done what? They've cut back on news? They've changed the format of news?
They've done a number of things. There have been many layoffs in traditional news organizations. Many people have been fired. And if you look at the labor force for the industry, it has gone down. they had cut down on expenses covering the news. You know, having a bureau in Afghanistan or in Asia or in any other part of the world outside of your home country is quite expensive. Mm-hmm. Right? And people do not necessarily gravitate to those news, to the news that come out of these bureaus in large amounts, enough to justify those expenses. So that coverage has been cut. And in the production of news usually takes, it's much more costly than, say, commentary or pundits talking on television,
right,
or opinion on newspapers or blogs or things like that.
It requires much more research and frequently a team of people.
Correct. Correct. So that has been cut as well. And instead of that, we see much more fluff, in a sense. Much more, sometimes it's fluff, sometimes it's not, but there is information that sometimes is not entirely corroborated. There is a lot, yeah, of commentary.
Now, in your book, you draw the distinction between public service information and non-public service.
Correct.
Right, and so the public service would be what you're talking about.
Correct.
News about the government, news about finance and business, things that the citizenry needs to be an informed voting,
correct,
public, right? And then non-public affairs would be everything else, entertainment, sports, whatever.
It is, right, mostly sports, entertainment, weather, and crime. These, mm-hmm, are the four big categories, with sports taking the lead.
It's interesting that you put crime in that category, that I would think crime might be a public policy issue. If it affects the neighborhood you live in, wouldn't it be?
Correct. It depends on how the subject is treated, right? Yes. It all depends on when there is a major crime or when there are minor crimes, but many of them, whether if it is covered in the news, it's covered just as crime, if it bleeds, it leads, versus, mm-hmm, these are the public policy implications or these are the political implications of the crime. And usually it's covered, for the most part, as if it bleeds, it leads.
And having watched enough television news, I would agree with that assessment. So, something else you brought up in the book is that one of the other areas that is suffering from this cutback in funds is investigative journalism.
Correct.
And you talk about the role of the media, it has several roles, one of which is as a watchdog of,
correct,
government,
mm-hmm,
but that's very time-consuming, very expensive,
correct,
and requires a long lead time of investigative digging, mm-hmm, that may or may not have a payoff at the end of it. Right, and so this has also suffered as a result of this constriction of funds?
Yes, it has suffered. The payoff for society is always there when, mm, there are these kinds of stories.
Right.
Right. There is a colleague of mine, an economist at Stanford, Jay Hamilton, who's writing a book about the benefits for society of investigative journalism, counting, for instance, the number of laws that are passed or, you know, legislative reform or things like that as a result of sound investigative journalism.
Mm-hmm.
But as you said, it's very costly to produce. And therefore, the impact on the bottom line of the news organizations that produce that usually is not commensurate with the resources that are invested,
right,
in that.
So the central premise of your book, given this background,
mm-hmm,
is about the disparity between what journalists want to produce,
correct,
and what the consumer wants to consume.
Correct.
So talk about that.
The news gap, the idea of the gap between what the audience needs or the public needs to know in order, mm-hmm, to function as informed members of the citizenry, news about national affairs, international, mm-hmm, affairs, business, finance, largely construed, on the one hand, those news, and on the other hand, the news that people want to consume, right? That gap has probably existed for a long time. Journalists and even academics have talked about it for a while, for decades actually, but it had never been fully systematically studied. So what we did in the book was try to ascertain whether there is such a gap between the needs and the wants,
mm-hmm,
right, of the citizenry. If there is such a gap, how small or large it might be, right? And again, if there is such a gap and is of a, you know, reasonable size, what are the factors that increase it, decrease it, or don't affect it?
Mm-hmm.
And so we undertook a series of studies over a multi-year period, about 6 years we did this, on and off. It's, mm-hmm, not that every day for six,
right,
years, but in seven different countries, 20 of the leading news sites on the internet across these countries, together the sites that we looked at the time we wrote the first version of the book, which is more than a year and a half ago, had a combined audience as measured in monthly unique visitors of more than of more than a quarter billion. So these were very large news organizations that were absolutely central in setting the agendas of their respective countries. So what we did was we looked at the difference between the stories that each of these news organizations considered to be the most newsworthy ones, the ones that were presented at the top of their respective homepages as the equivalent of the above the fold in the print newspaper on the front page, right? So on the one hand, we look at those stories, and on the other hand, we looked at the stories that the audience of each of these news organizations clicked on most often, emailed to their friends, family members most often, and commented for the world at large to see most often. And we tried to see whether there was a difference, a gap, as we call it, between the stories that were more prominently displayed on the side, on the one hand, and on the other hand, the stories that were capturing the attention of the public in these three ways most often.
Now, one of the things I thought was interesting was that there was quite a difference between what people clicked on and what people emailed to their friends.
Correct.
So how did those fall out?
So people click on, usually, the stories that are interesting to them, with a very large number of those being about what we call non-public affairs news. Again, mostly sports, weather, entertainment, and crime.
Or unusual stories, into bizarre stuff, right?
Those are the stories that people email the most
often. Right.
People click on what's interesting and email what is either bizarre or what is very useful to them, what is called news you can use. Right? There is inflation in this and that country, so these are the 10 ways in which you can protect your assets. Right? That is, in a sense, a business story, if you wish, but it's treated mostly as news you can use, not as a policy issue, nor as a political issue in general.
Now, you also talked about an interesting concept called, and if I get the name correct, the monitoring function.
Correct.
Where citizens will monitor the news, and particularly in times of heightened political activity or whatever, a presidential election, a crisis, the monitoring function, they will tune in more to the public affairs type
Correct.
Of things. So how does that work, and why do you think that exists that way?
So let me give you the background so that we can then discuss your question. So what we did in the case of the media that we studied in the United States is we looked at six of the leading news organizations online in this country: the Washington Post, USA Today, ABC, CBS, Fox News, and CNN, during 5 years, 2008, 9, 10, 11, and 12, around election time, starting in August and ending in December, starting in 08, 3 weeks before the first party convention, and ending roughly 3 weeks after election, a little bit more than three weeks. December 1st election was November 4th, 2008. Then we went on the same sites for 14 days around election day in 2009. We went again, right? And again in 2010 during the midterm congressionals, right, the peak of Tea Party performance, at least so far. Then again in 2011, no electoral process, no major electoral process. And then again in 2012, right, during what ended up being the Obama re-election campaign. And we tried to see whether this gap, which is fairly large during normal political times, whether it was affected by the ups and downs of the political process, right, the electoral process.
And again, you're measuring by clicks and by email
Correct.
Activity, right?
Correct. We contrast the stories that are most prominently displayed as an indication of what all of these media organizations think are the most important stories, right? The equivalent of top of the hour on television or above the fold on the front page. These are the stories that you see on the first scroll of your screen, right? And we contrast that with the stories that are clicked most often, right? Emailed most often and commented most often. And what happens is that at the peak of the electoral process, in 2008 and 2012, we see a significant reduction of the gap. It doesn't disappear altogether, but it reduces its magnitude considerably. Now, as soon as the election is over, we go back to regular business, right? And the gap expands dramatically.
People start following sports and movies again.
Absolutely. Right? Absolutely. So what we argue is that the citizens are monitoring the political, the business, the international news scene from a distance. If there is a particular topic, like an election or a major crisis, economic or political, international, etc., then that captures the imagination of the population, and the population goes, right, and starts reading or watching or listening to those stories. Mm-hmm. As soon as the crisis is over, they go back to business.
So as I read that in the book, I thought about the history and prior to being able to measure this, or go back to before the commercial internet, mm-hmm. even before cable news. And I would assume that, and you've talked about the gap has been a subject of debate for many years, mm-hmm. that the gap probably was there.
I agree.
So is it reasonable to think that even though there have been these cutbacks in news production as a result of the changing economics of mm-hmm. the situation, that perhaps the public is as well informed anyway, because maybe despite all that work that the news stations did, nobody paid attention to it. Is that conceivable?
It is conceivable, although I don't agree entirely. So for a number of reasons. When there is this oversupply, right, of content, mm-hmm. you are more likely to run into it, even if serendipitously, than when there is less of that, number mm-hmm. one. Number two, if you think about a newspaper and how people read a newspaper, right? So they open the paper and they flip through the pages.
Right.
Right. They may not spend more than a few seconds until they reach the story or the stories that they want to read. Mm-hmm. But at least they see the headlines, mm-hmm. right? And some of those headlines might capture their imagination and they might stop there. It's the same as you go to the library, right? And you are looking for a particular book in the stacks, mm-hmm. you see other titles, and then, mm-hmm. whoops, you grab that, right? You don't do that on Amazon so often.
Rarely. Right? Well, they recommend it for you, but then that's recommendations based on your tastes,
exactly.
not something that might be completely unrelated.
Exactly. If you think about how people watched television in the 60s, say, Walter Cronkite or any other mm-hmm. news anchor, they were in a 30-minute television news segment, newscast, there were six or seven stories, right? You had to sit through story one, two, three, four, even if you were interested in story five, right? There
yes.
was no VCR. You had to sit
right,
through that, right?
Right. right.
So you were incidentally exposed to that content mm-hmm. much more so than you are exposed now. If you think about now the internet, the web, you can very easily get all the information that you are interested in and avoid all the rest, either by going to a site and going exactly into the stories that you're interested in, or, as many people do, subscribing into services that feed them directly mm-hmm. headlines of the stories with links of mm-hmm. the stories that they want to read and ignore completely the rest. So it is conceivable that all of these trends are fairly new, but if they continue, that is, say, 10 years, the population might be considerably less informed than what they were before.
Do you think this contributes? We talk a lot about the extreme polarization of the parties and society, red states and blue states, and how there seems to be less and less common language.
Correct.
In fact, I saw a wonderful diagram, I think it might have been from The Guardian or maybe The Economist, mm-hmm. About the United States Congress. And it showed Congress from 20 years ago, and there were lines that connected each of the senators from the Republicans and the Democrats. And every line that connected said that this was a time that these two worked in harmony mm-hmm. on a bill or voted the same way. Mm-hmm. And seeing that same diagram, and it's, you know, it's like a network diagram, all these connections, it's a kind mm-hmm. of hash. And it looks like one kind of amoeba-like organism with a lot of crisscrossing lines.
Right.
And 20 years later, it looks like an amoeba that is dividing.
Right.
And the number of connections is a tiny fraction of what it was before. Mm-hmm. So is this self-selection of news? I mean, it seems to obvious. I mean, it seems like I'm asking the obvious question.
It is contributing. It is not causing that. You know, political mm-hmm. polarization has other roots, mm-hmm. right? But this is certainly contributing to that because we are more and more living in a society in which we get exposed to the perspectives and the information that speak to us, mm-hmm. right? And can easily ignore the rest.
Right.
Right?
So in your book, you talk about several possible prescriptions mm-hmm. for this. And the fact that it does have such public policy implications, and as you said, that we become potentially a much more, much less informed society.
Correct.
And we make worse choices as a result. So talk about the four possible solutions that you see.
So the main solution, we see alternatives that are not necessarily particularly fruitful in our mm-hmm. perspective. Like, for instance, it is possible for any of these reputable news organizations to start giving the audience more of what the audience wants and less of what it needs. That's what tabloids do, mm-hmm. right? And they are very successful at that. So by doing that, right, which is an alternative, mm-hmm. and we see some evidence of that, they can, in the short term, get more clicks, right? But in the longer term, they are diluting their credibility, which is one of their main assets. And they are right. entering probably into a marketplace that is already crowded, which is
the tabloids. Right.
Exactly. So the main solution for us, given that it's not that the audience is always uninterested mm-hmm. in political news or international news or economic news, but is cyclically, right, interested, and it's depending on the context and the nature of the historical moment we live in, maybe more or less interested, is to try to restructure the news production process, which usually inside news organizations, there is a very rigid division of labor. Mm-hmm. The people who cover politics cover only politics, you know, and they're very deep and specialized in that coverage, but mm-hmm. they don't do anything else.
They don't do business, for example.
They
right?
don't do business, they don't do sports.
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yes.
They don't do entertainment.
Right.
Right? So what we propose is to try to move to a more flexible mode of production in which people in the newsroom are trained to cover different subject matters, which in very small news organizations you see that, mm-hmm. but not in the New York Times or in the Washington Post or in the Guardian that you mentioned mm-hmm. or in the larger, right? So people are acquiring a more flexible skill set and a broader knowledge of different subject matters so that news organizations can get in and out of providing certain topics, news about certain topics, depending on the interests of the population.
Now, conceptually, that certainly sounds appealing.
Right.
But logistically, or actually implementing that, I can see any number of problems that
Correct.
Would arise from that. One being resistance from the journalists who say,
Correct.
I'm not going to cover sports? That's ridiculous. I'm a White House correspondent and I'm not going to lower myself to sports. Or the sports guy who says, hey, I don't give a hoot about those idiots in Washington. I want to cover the teams I'm interested in.
Right.
So getting those to meld together would be hard. And the other
Correct.
Thing I think about is that then, even if that's successful, training journalists in the future mm-hmm. will be extremely hard because you have to become very good at many different subjects.
Correct.
Which you're in the university. You know that's one of
yes.
the most segmented areas of
yes.
the world, right?
Yes.
People are very specialized because
yes.
it's very hard to be an expert on
yes.
a wide range of subjects.
I agree.
So, I mean, how would we handle that?
The thing is that the alternative is not so rosy in terms of picture, right? So it is a major challenge, as you said, logistically and culturally, right? As a managerial challenge, right, mm-hmm. That has the logistical implications, how to do that, right? Anywhere from the training to the production process, the workflow, et cetera, mm-hmm. to how to manage a major change in culture. But if the alternative is continuing the layoffs, continuing the closing of foreign bureaus, decreasing the level of resources allocated to news budgets, et cetera, I think that sense of urgency can certainly motivate people in the newsroom to change.
Well, it's an interesting conjecture.
Certainly is.
Yes, we'll have to see if that plays out. As I think about it, I wonder whether the news organizations see this in these terms. And it actually brings me up to the book. Actually, can we get a shot of the book? Here's the cover
Absolutely.
Of the book. Yeah, and see if we can. There we go. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, right there. And then we'll see, zoom in on that for a second. There we go. The news gap. So I like your cover design, too.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. So I wonder, have you reached out to news organizations with this study? I mean, this seems really relevant to their business model.
Yes.
What kind of reception have you received?
So the reception is mixed. They tend to agree almost uniformly that this is their reality.
So they agree with your analysis.
They agree. They know this even better than I do. They live
that reality
day in, day out. Mm-hmm. Right? Even news organizations like the BBC, right, which, you know, with its tradition and with its level of funding, you would expect that the people who go to the BBC, right, to the BBC news website, would gravitate towards, you know, international news, towards political news. We did an experiment with my undergraduate students in the fall quarter class that I teach on the sociology of online news. We examined the BBC site. That makes public available all this traffic data by region of the world, even, on a three-day period. Mm-hmm. And there were times of the day in which 100% of the top 10 most viewed stories were not about public affairs news. 100%. 10 out of 10.
Okay? So even the BBC?
Even the BBC. In talking informally to editors at the BBC, they confirmed it, yes, what you describe is our bread and butter. Now, news organizations know that this is going on. They have not been extremely reflexive in their opening up to a dialogue about what could be done. It's a little bit of a sense of, well, yes, it's going on, but we don't want to talk about it. Not in public. Right?
Well, not in public, yeah, but...
Behind closed doors, of course they know and they talk about that, right?
Do they treat you as an outsider and what do you know? You're just some guy in a university and you don't live where we live?
I am largely an outsider in the sense that I am not a former journalist and the study was not sponsored by any news organization. And I teach in a university. I don't teach, you know, work inside, say, a think tank for the news industry. They are extremely receptive to me as a person, and I have always had wonderful conversations. But when it comes to having public dialogue, this is something that is mostly kept behind closed doors, as it were.
So what is your plan for the book? It brings up a broader question. We only have about 2 minutes left, but who's the audience for the book? Who are you trying to reach here? Is it the industry or is it consumers like me?
So the book, it's interesting. We had a dilemma with my co-author about whether to write what is called a trade book or a scholarly book. We had three different publishers interested in publishing this book. We ended up publishing with MIT Press. And even with MIT Press, we had that dilemma. We decided, because this is a lot of research, we based our analysis on several years' worth of research, 50,000 news stories that were read one by one individually in several languages, actually, because there are seven countries, as I said, involved, not just English. And we wanted to convey the depth of the analysis and the depth of the study. We wrote it as accessibly as possible for multiple audiences, but it is a scholarly book. It is, we hope that it will reach members of the industry, which it has, I know, because I've had many conversations, and the general public who's interested in news topics.
Well, with that, we're out of time. So I want to thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
And I hope you'll come back again soon.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Professor Pablo Boczkowsk.
You're welcome.
And thank you for joining us on Public Perspective. I'm your host, Kevin McDermott. You can find us every Saturday night on Comcast Channel 19 and on the web at publicperspective.tv. Till next time, thank you and good night.